Well, we're glad we don't worship like that. Amen. Amen. You know, that's why I'm grateful that we have a worship pastor that leads us in an authentic way. Amen. But you know what? Sometimes the words may not be that distorted, but when we sing to the Lord, sometimes we're being that self-focused, aren't we? I want you guys to know that whenever Jeffery's leading us in worship and we are participating in that worship, that we need to look at those songs we sing, the words that we lift up to God as prayers to Father. Do you know it's been said before that the time where Christians lie the most are on Sunday morning during worship time. Amen. You got all these things you're praying and singing to God about how you're committed to Him and it's all about Him, but our heart could not be saying something any different than that. Jesus spoke about that to me, the hypocrites, right? He said their mouths, their tongues praise me, but their heart is far from me. And sometimes that is most crystal clear and obvious during our worship on Sunday mornings. But I'm grateful that we have a worship pastor that brings every Sunday a heart of worship for us, and that we get to respond back to Him. We say often here at the Mission Church that worship is not a spectator sport, amen? It is something that we participate in together. And I'm grateful today to be able to recognize that and to be able to lift that truth up. Okay, if you have your Bible, your copy of God's Word, lift it up high and proud, and give me a little Bible clap here this morning. Show you God's Word. All right. In that, turn to 1 Timothy chapter 3. 1 Timothy chapter 3. It's hard to do that with the phone, isn't it? It's hard to do that with a phone. 1 Timothy chapter 3 today. Today is our ordination service for Jeffery. Now I want you to remember though that this is only a time, not only a time for celebration, it's also a time for reflection. This is a time not only to celebrate what God has already been doing in the heart and the life of Jeffery. I have known Jeffery for many years, as has most and many of you. And we know that he has a heart for service, a heart for worship. He already has a pastoral heart. At our ordination council yesterday, I asked Jeffery, one of my favorite questions to ask at a council is, if we as a council of ordained pastors chose not to ordain you, Jeffery, what would you do? And he had the very best answer. I just continue to do what I've already been doing. Amen? So, ordination primarily comes from God. It comes from God. Laying the hands on a man, what we're going to do in a few minutes, does not transfer anything other than germs. God is the one that puts the anointing on his life. Amen. We are simply just recognizing that as a church. I'm honored to be able to do this as his pastor, but more so as his friend. And I have no reservations in my heart at all that this is exactly what God is doing, and it's exactly the time for us to celebrate it as a local church. But it's also a time for him to be reflective on his life, and not just he, but his lovely wife, Pamela. Understand that being called in an official capacity as an ordained pastor has not only great benefits, it has great responsibilities. The Bible clearly teaches to whom much is given, much is required. The Bible is very clear that those who are in leadership positions have a great responsibility. James 3:1 is something we talked about yesterday. In James 3:1, it says that those who are in positions of leadership, especially pastors and preachers and teachers of God's Word, are held to an even higher standard. That God looks at them and says, I hold you to a higher standard because you are leading other people. And just as God holds pastors to a higher standard many times, the devil knows the same thing and will attack spiritual leaders with a fervor that's without question. Becoming a pastor in that official capacity, that target just gets bigger on your back for the spiritual warfare that is absolutely real. The devil knows that in the forest, if a small sapling falls over, no one hardly notices. But a large oak tree, if it falls over, takes many other smaller trees with it. You know what I mean? So that's what happens for a pastor. A leader in official capacity, that if they were to fall, have a moral failing, or have flaws in their character, or they're able to fall into known sin, that brings down a larger group of people. And the devil knows that. It's one of his key tactics to try to get them to stumble. And I told Jeffrey yesterday, if the devil can't get to you, he's going to go after your family. So we need to be in prayer for Pamela just as much as we are for Jeffrey. We need to be in prayer for his dear mama, and in prayer for Callie and the other grandkids. We need to be praying for this family, because the devil knows that if he can't get to that leader, the quickest way to get to them is their family. Amen? The devil knew that for my life. Even recently, had some threat up on my family, and nothing's going to get a papa bear more angry quicker than a threat up on your family. Amen? Amen. So we've got to have our spiritual guard up. You know, Jeffrey and I have talked quite at length about that today. Not only that, it's a time for us as a church to be reflective of our own lives. Some of the qualifications, some of the characteristics that we're going to unpack together today in 1 Timothy chapter 3 are specific for pastors and deacons, the two official offices of a New Testament church, but they're characteristics that should be in every one of our lives. These should be traits that are in every child of God's life. Jeff did a wonderful job of articulating that yesterday. He said, yeah, I know that this is a big responsibility. I know that I'm not worthy of doing this. I know that God's going to hold me more accountable. But at the same time, I know that God has these expectations and desire for every born-again child of God. Understand, that's always been God's plan. That we, every one of us, are a priesthood of believers. That every one of us, regardless of how long you've been saved, regardless of your background, regardless of your personality, regardless of your gender, God wants every one of us to be a servant for Him. Every child of God is a minister. You may not be a pastor, you may not be a missionary, you may not be in an official vocational position where you're getting paid for ministry. You may be working at Walmart, you may be working at the police department, you may be working in an office somewhere, you may be a housewife, or I like the term domestic engineer. But whatever God has called you to do, that is your ministry. Amen.
Amen.
That in the Christian perspective, there is no difference between sacred and secular. There's no difference between what's holy and what's not. If you are a child of God, the Holy Spirit lives inside of you, and everything you do is holy unto the Lord. Amen. The Bible clearly says that, Old and New Testament the same. It says, whatever you put your hand to, you do it as unto the Lord. Whatever you do is holy in God's sight. Not necessarily because you are super special. Not because you're super gifted or super talented. Actually, the Bible says that God chooses to use the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God chooses to use the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty. Why? Because that's when He gets all the glory. Amen.
Amen.
It's whenever God uses the most unlikely sources to do amazing things, God's name is lifted the highest. So it's not about having the talent, not having the resources. It's simply being obedient to the Holy Spirit of God that's in you. Every one of us, the moment you came to faith in Christ, you received the Holy Spirit. He came to live in your life. It's not a matter of getting more of the Holy Spirit. It's a matter of you giving more of yourself to the Holy Spirit. Amen? Being more and more yielded to Him. Allowing Him to have more and more control of your life. And I can guarantee you, everybody in here, God wants to use you in a tailor-made way to influence the world around you. So today's a time of celebration, but it's also a time of reflection. Not only for Jeffrey and Pamela, but also for ourselves. We're going to look here at 1 Timothy chapter 3. We've got 3 points to break this down. I'm a Baptist preacher. 3 points. Here we go. Number one, the shepherds of the church. These are the shepherds of the church. You see that verses 1 through 13. We begin with the qualifications of an overseer or of a bishop. Those are just transferable terms for the pastor. This is a faithful saying. If a man desires the position of a bishop, he desires a good work. And saying, if a man desires to be a pastor, he desires a noble thing. You know, I hear sometimes that people say, hey, God called me into the ministry kicking and screaming. It was the very last thing I wanted to do. I wanted to be whatever, circus clown or whatever it was. And God just called me out of that, made me a preacher. Sometimes I question those testimonies. The Bible says in Psalm 37:4 that God gives you the desires of your heart. So I think that doesn't mean that God gives you whatever your heart desires. It means that God places in your heart the desires He wants for you. So I think that God puts this thing stirring in your heart where you just have a longing to serve Jesus, and it begins to grow and form, and you have people speaking into your life and opportunities before you. This is just what God has to be designed to do. This is just what God has formed me to do. This is what God's equipped me to do. That's why one of the best questions to ask somebody who wants to go into ministry is say, hey, if you can do anything else than ministry, you ought to do it. Because I can tell you, being in the ministry has its own unique challenges. And the only thing that will keep you in that ministry is a calling from God on your life. Whenever the people aren't necessarily following you, even whenever frustrations arise, when there's always more work to be done, I can tell you in ministry there's always another call to make, another set to prepare for, someone else to pray with, another program to develop. There's always more to be done. And sometimes it can be frustrating, but if God's calling is on your life, you can't do anything else. So you're able, whenever God's calling your life, you don't take all the credit when things are going well, but you also don't take all the blame when things are not going well. Amen? You're trusting God's sovereignty in that process. You're saying, God, it's not because of me, it's because of you and your grace and blessing through me. He goes on to say, bishops then must be blameless. That's not sinless. That's blameless. That means that all of us as children of God, that we all have stuff and baggage in our lives. Amen? Amen. We all have that internal struggle that's going on, but we should be gaining victory day by day. That we should be able not only to, we will never be sinless, but we should sin less with time. We should be being conformed to the image of Christ, and our life being characterized by a heart being turned to God. And no child of God should be characterized by ongoing, unconfessed sin. If someone looks at your life and says, that person is fill in the blank, more they can say that person is a lover of Jesus, then you need to question where you are in your salvation. That's anything that takes a presence over God's presence in your life. If someone knows you for you fill in the blank, a glutton, a thief, a drunkard, a drug dealer, an adulterer, whatever it is. If someone thinks of you and your life is characterized by ongoing unknown sin, you need to question your salvation and make sure Jesus truly has a grip upon your life. The husband of one wife, temperate, sober-minded, of good behavior, hospitable, able to teach. And this is bringing in the family into the equation. We'll see that on down through here. As we said before, the family is so critical. Understand there's no great men in the world without even greater wife behind them. Amen? Amen?
Amen.
All right. Amen. I can tell you, when I do weddings and do premarital counseling, I tell the wives that nobody will have a greater influence on this man than you. That's the way God designed it to be. Whether you like it or not, I don't care what the Bible says. Amen.
Amen.
It says that the man and the woman are both equal, but they're unique. They are equal, but they're different. And God has different roles for them and different capacities for them. And what I have seen in God's economy, in God's ways, that a man can accomplish great things, even if they are limited resources and abilities, if they've got a woman at home that says, I believe in you. You can do this. I've got your back. And even if you fall short, I am there for you. A man will go out and charge helpless work out of that kind of support at home. Amen?
Amen.
But the same token, a man can have a lot of giftedness, a lot of ability, a lot going for him. They have a woman at home that's nagging them and pulling them down and distracting them and talking down to them. That woman has greater voice in his life than anybody else. So Pamela, our charge to you is be this man as you have been. Be his greatest support, greatest cheerleader, greatest fan. Jeffery says you are his greatest support and his greatest critic, and that's a good thing. And that's a good thing. Continue to do that, but always speak the truth of love. Amen. It's like the man who preached a message one Sunday, he felt so good about it. He got in the car, you know, wanted to kind of, you know, get his wife to say something good. She said, "Man, sweetie, how many truly great preachers do you think there are in the world?" She said, "Well, I'm quite sure there's one less than you think." Verse 3. Not given to wine, not violent, not greedy for money, but gentle, not quarrelsome, and not covetousness. Okay, so verse says not given to wine. So this is talking about any vice. Again, this is anything that can get a hold of your life and prevent you from letting God be first place. One thing I'm super proud of Jeffery for, super proud of this. Jeffery for many years was a smoker. Smoked cigarettes for many, many years. And you know, that's not something that necessarily would have prevented this ordination, but it is something that you want to look at and make sure. But with him choosing about 2 years ago through the power of the Holy Spirit to allow the Holy Spirit to take prominence in that area, to free him from that addiction, has just shown me just that level of commitment, that level of desire, that level of removing anything that may be a stumbling block in his life. One story I tell is kind of lighthearted, but years ago, Jeffery's so good in VBS, so much energy, walked in one day kind of in a hurry, had a cigarette behind his ear. I said, "Jeff, we may want to not do that in front of the kids, right? Don't leave." But what I love is no one said you have to do this. No one said, "Hey, you've got to quit smoking so that you can have a position in ministry or whatever." But he chose to do that of his own accord. Because in his heart, between him and Jesus, he knew this is something that's holding me back. Maybe this is something that prevents someone from looking at me in that role as a spiritual leader. Whatever it was, he made that decision. And that shows that he's serious about this calling upon his life. And for that, I encourage him often. One thing that brings joy to me to know about him. One who rules his own house well, having his children in submission with all reverence. Again, if you can't lead your family well, you can't lead in the church well. That doesn't mean that the family's perfect. Guess what? Even the man of the household who is accountable to God to lead spiritually still can only give account primarily themselves. Amen. Our children and those that we've raised up, all we can do is the very best we can. And then we have to trust that God loves them even more than we do. That's just the reality of it. People are ultimately responsible for their own choices between them and God. And every one of us has family members that have done things and said things and been things that maybe we wouldn't have planned it that way. But God is the one that holds them accountable, right? My family, not only my family, but my extended family, we put the fun in dysfunctional. If you knew all of our mess, you'd say, "Whoa, you're our preacher." I can tell you, that's all of us, amen? Just because you are a pastor doesn't mean you're exempt from the same life struggles that anyone else has. It simply means that God set you apart for a specific purpose. And that's why we need your prayers just as much as anybody, maybe more so. I love Paul all throughout Scripture. He's got a huge prayer list. He told all a bunch of people in church, "I'm praying for you on a daily basis." But so many times he also said, "Pray for me. I need your prayers. Pray that God will give me boldness. Pray that God will give me direction. Pray that God will help me to be faithful with what God's called me to." And Jeffery and I know Pastor Randall would echo the same thing. We need the prayers. You need the practice. So keep them coming. Amen. He goes on to say, "For if a man does not know how to rule his own house, how he take care of the church of God, not a novice that's being puffed up with pride, he fall into the same condemnation as the devil. Moreover, he must have a good testimony among those who are outside, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil." And then in verse 8, we go to the qualifications of a deacon. Again, pastor and deacon are the only two official offices laid out in the church for the New Testament church through the Bible. And we have other positions, right? We got secretaries, and we got people who handle different capacities, and kids ministry, and volunteers, and all these different things. But these are the two positions. But think about this. The word deacon simply means servant. And guess what? Every one of us should be servants. Amen?
Amen.
And these qualifications should apply to all of our lives. It says this, "Likewise, deacons must be reverent, not double-tongued, not given to much wine, not greedy for money, holding the mystery of faith with a pure conscience.
let these also first be tested. Then let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. I love that Jeffery has been tested. A principle in God's economy is this. If you're faithful with the small things, then God can trust you with greater things. If God gives you the greater things early, you're not able to handle it. If you're able to handle the small things along the way, then God can trust you down the road. I've seen Jeffery do so many things over the years, behind the scenes, backstage, no recognition, no attention for it, consistently day in, week out. He has been faithful with the small things. And I believe this is just another step in the greater things that God has in store for him. But the truth is the same for every one of us. Can God trust you with the small things? If he can trust you with the small things, then he might be able to trust you with greater things as time progresses. But let these first be tested, that let them serve as deacons, being found blameless. Likewise, their wives must be reverent, not slanderers, temperate, faithful in all things. Let deacons be the husband of one wife, ruling their children and their own house as well. And again, just a side note, that word ruling doesn't mean the ruling like someone who is holding someone down with an iron thumb or an iron fist. By ruling, it simply means, we know from elsewhere, that the husband is like Christ to the church. Right? And how did Christ love the church? In a sacrificial way. Putting the church's needs above his very own. Willing to die for the church. And that's what a man is to do for his wife. Die maybe not physically, though most men worth their weight would jump in front of a speeding train or a shooting bullet to die for their bride. But more importantly, will you live for them? Will you put them above your own needs and desires? Will you die daily to your own wishes so that your wife can be the best version of themselves, to be most like Christ they can possibly be? Again, I know no relationship is perfect. We all got our struggles, but I know that Jeffery has a heart for his wife, and he desires to pastor his wife well. And Pamela many times articulated to me how Jeffery has shown Christ in their marriage. How he's demonstrated grace and forgiveness and mercy and unconditional love, all those things that says that he rules or leads his family well. For those who have served well as a deacon obtain for themselves a good standing and great boldness in the faith which is in Christ Jesus. A lion and a rabbit. Here's a poem for you guys. You'll love this. The lion met a tiger as they drank beside the pool. Said the tiger to the lion, "Why do you roar like a fool?" "That's not foolish," said the lion with a twinkle in his eyes. "They call me the king of beasts because I advertise." A rabbit heard them talking and ran home like a streak. He thought he'd try the lion's plan, but his roar was only a squeak. And fox then heard the rabbit. He had dinner in the woods. "So when you advertise, my friends, be sure you've got the goods." Jeffery, I tell you this, my brother, make sure you got the goods. You're stepping into this role and saying, "God, I'm ready to say yes to you," even before knowing all the details. These characteristics, these qualifications, they need to be in your life. This isn't just a beginning. It's not the end. This is the beginning for you. Stay on your spiritual tippy toes. Stay vigilant. Stay on guard. Make sure Jesus always stays first in your life and in your ministry and in your family. Pamela, same for you. Stay on your toes. You're in this capacity, and God expects you to live up to it. Not in your own ability, but in leading the Holy Spirit in your lives together. Number two, very quickly, this is the sheep in the church. The sheep in the church. We had the shepherds first, now it's the sheep. Beginning in verse 14, it says this, "These things I write to you, though I hope to come to you shortly. But if I'm delayed, I write so that you may know how you ought to conduct yourself in the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of truth." In just a matter of moments, we'll be giving some charges to Jeffery to be able to affirm, to say, "I will to." I'm also going to give some charges to you as the Mission Church of Lexington that you will commit to as well. We can expect some things from Jeffery and Pamela, that they'll live lives above reproach, that they'll serve with love and tenderness, that they'll be spirit-led in all that they do, that they'll never do anything to bring a black eye to our church or, more importantly, to the kingdom of God. But we've also got some responsibilities to them. that we pray for them, that we love them, that we follow leadership that they have, that we affirm them in this position. The Bible is really clear about how we're supposed to respect and follow the leadership in the church because they're going to give an account for the ministry that they have. Hebrews 13:17. It's a high and holy calling for both of us. And I can tell you this, I know this firsthand as a shepherd of the church. It hurts really bad when the sheep bite. It hurts really bad whenever those who you love and you care for and you minister to, and they turn around and they bite you through gossip or through slander, or they hurt you through a variety of things that can happen inside of church life. By God's grace, the year that we've been in operation, that's not been an issue in this church. Every one of you shows all of our pastoral staff love and support. And again, we would never be naive enough to say that we'll never make mistakes along the way, right? But we want to be humble enough to be able to receive encouragement, direction, accountability, all those things that are necessary. But we want to do it all in love. Amen.
Amen.
It hurts when the sheep bite. And for the pastors, those who are called this capacity, goals that God has for us. Number one is to save the goats, serve the sheep, and shoot the wolves. Amen? Save the goats. The Bible has this picture, characterizes those who are lost as goats, those who are saved as sheep. And it says that we as Christians, especially pastors, but for all of us, our goal is to save the goats, turn the goats into sheep, get the gospel to those who are not yet part of the family of God. Then serve the sheep. That's what God's called us, not to be lords over the sheep, but to be servants to the sheep. To help the sheep to be protected, to help the sheep be fed, to help the sheep be safe. That's what the pastors are doing. Ephesians 4:11-12 says this, that the pastor's job is to equip you for the work of the ministry. My job, Jeffrey's job, Pastor Randall's job is to help every one of you to find your skill set, to find your spiritual giftedness, find your interest levels, use your personalities, and put you in positions where you can serve God in the most effective way possible. Nothing makes me happier than being able to do that. And that's our dream as a church. We plan to plant churches every 3 years, all across Commonwealth and beyond. And for that to happen, we have to have a strong farm system of leaders. Amen? We've got to find people who are gifted in a variety of ways, preaching and teaching and singing, playing instruments and doing administrative stuff and running technology things, doing greeting ministry, working with kids, all the stuff that's necessary for a church to function. We're looking for you to help you to develop, take your next spiritual step of obedience. And of course, lastly is to shoot the wolves, right? The Bible's clear that the pastors are to guard the flock. Whatever false teaching were to come in, you have people with ill intent who will come in, whether it's physical or spiritual or relational harm, we are to protect the flock by shooting or defending off the wolves. That's why, you know, one small way that we do that in our kids' ministry, we have a very copious security process. Background checks and security areas and registration and policies and procedures and what if things were to happen, if we have issues, what would kids want? My wife and her team have looked through all this because we want to protect the sheep, amen? Especially those lambs in the back. Lastly, the Savior of the church. See that verse 16. The Savior of the church. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen by angels, preached among the Gentiles, believed on in the world, and received up into glory. Who's that talking about? Jesus Christ, amen. That's what all this is about. That's what all the shepherds are for. That's what all the sheep are about. That's why we're doing what we're doing today. It's because it's all about Jesus Christ. And if we miss that, we've missed everything. I can tell you, my friends, in this room today, there's going to be folks who do not yet have a relationship with the Savior, the church. That you've never come to a place where you've trusted in Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You've never repented of your sin. That you're thinking to yourself, well, my sins aren't really that bad. Or you're saying, my sins are too bad. Either way, it's a distortion of reality. The Bible says that every human being that's ever lived, including you and including me, are sinners. By birth and by choice. It's something that we are by default. It's something that we are by choice and decision. that we make ourselves separated from God because of our sin. God's holy, and we're not. There's not one thing that we can do to earn a relationship with God. You can never be good enough on your best day for God to say, boy, I'd love to have you on my team. I'm fortunate to have you here. It doesn't work that way. We're sinners, broken, separated, undeserving, but God says, I still choose you. Reminds me of an artist who one day, looking through the small little shops of his little hometown, found in a refuge bin, a little antique store, one of his favorite artwork pieces he had sold years ago. But now it's busted and broken, not beautiful any longer. Now this artist, though he was the creator of that masterpiece that's now looks like it's ready to be thrown away, he couldn't just walk in and say, hey, that's mine, and take it out. He had to buy that piece, right? He had to pay for it to the clerk, then it was his, then he took it home and he restored it better than before. That's the story of salvation for us. That we are creations of God. Every one of us who has breath in our lungs are here by God's plan and God's purpose. We're not here by happenstance. We're not here by circumstance. We're not here on accident. We're here on the purpose of God. And He sees us in our broken and bruised and destroyed conditions.
Amen.
That may be on the outside because of life choices we have made, but it's definitely on the inside. Some of our sins are visible to others, but all of us have sins in our hearts, secret sins known to God, maybe God alone. And even one sin separates us from the holiness of God. Even one sin in our life prevents us from having the relationship with God that He wants for us. We've got to do something with it. The question is your sin upon Christ, or is it on you? If your sin is upon you, you're not living to the fullest potential in this life, but more importantly, when you die, you go to a sinner's hell. That's not a popular statement, but it's a reality. The Bible teaches that truth. But God also gives a way for us to escape that reality. It says that if you have a relationship with Christ, if you receive Him by faith, He becomes your Lord and your Savior, that you don't have to be fearful of hell. You can have hope in heaven. You can have the knowledge you'll be with Christ forever, but you'll also know that in this life you'll have a purpose, that God has a purpose and a plan and a meaning for you. You no longer have to live a life of lostness. You can live a life of purpose. Our motto here at the Mission Church is we want everybody to find their why. Friends, your why, number one, is to know Christ as your Savior. Have your sins forgiven. But after that, your why is to find out why you are forgiven. Why has Christ given you salvation? Because He's not saved you to sit and soak. He has saved you to serve. To be an ambassador for Him. To be used by Him. To be His hands, to be His feet, to be His mouth, to be an instrument of His grace. Some of you in this room may be called out one day to be a pastor, an ordained pastor, vocational minister, as we're identifying for Jeffery. That may not be for you, but you are certainly called to be a minister for Jesus. He's asking you to be His witness wherever you're at, your normal traffic patterns of life. So, question for you today is: in our time of response, are you saved? Have you trusted Christ? And two, do you know why you're saved? Are you serving God by serving people? Are you being the life, the Christian person that Christ wants you? Heads bowed, eyes closed. So Jeffery, do you before God and by His grace covenant to the following principles? If so, after each one, answer, I do. Do you covenant to keep watch over your life, seeking to live in a manner pleasing to God and worthy of His calling? Do you covenant to watch over and pray for the flock of God entrusted to your care as one who must give an account? Do you covenant to love, guide, and care for God's people, not by constraint, but from a willing spirit? not motivated by personal gain, but eager to serve, not lording it over those entrusted to you, but rather being an example to the flock. Do you covet to set an example for other believers in speech, in life, in love, in faith, and in purity? Do you covet to love your family, to manage your own household well, and to maintain a good reputation in the community? Do you covet to study the scriptures that you may teach what is according to the sound doctrine and handle God's word correctly to the best of your ability? Do you covet in your teaching to show integrity, seriousness, and soundness of speech befitting the word of God? You covenant to preach God's word, to be prepared in season and out of season, to correct, to rebuke, and encourage with patience and careful instruction. You covenant to proclaim the whole counsel of God from the scripture without fear or hesitation. Do you covenant to discharge faithfully all the duties of your ministry in a manner that is honorable to both God and man? Do you covenant to love, to encourage and to help your husband in his gospel ministry? Church family, Mission Church of Lexington, do you before God and by His grace covenant to the following? If so, answer, we do. Do you covenant to love, to encourage, to support, to pray for Pastor Jeffery and his wife as he serves as a pastor and a servant leader of this local church?
We do.
Anybody who's an ordained pastor or deacon, you're ordained in ministry, I welcome you to come forward and lay hands upon this couple. But make your way up now. Or anybody who's ordained, make your way up now.
Getting over, man, it's hard. But you're
God, it's been my blessing to watch Jeffery grow from a teenager to a young adult to a grown man to a husband to a grandfather of love, and now to this position as pastor of our church. Father, I just pray that as my days grow to the end, that Jeffery will be a pastor to me and bless me for the rest of my life. Father, we just give you thanks for being here. We just pray, Lord, that you'll continue to stand beside him, strengthen him, encourage him, and even be a critic to him. Father, we pray these things in Jesus' name.
Father, as we stand here this morning, I just can't help but thank you, Brother Jerry. Father, how proud that he has been down with this young man. Yes. Father, I just ask you to bless the man, Jeff.
Proud of you guys. Just be praying for you. Let's encourage them in the Lord. Yeah, amen. Amen. Well, you can just encourage them as they grab their seats, but we're so proud. We'll pray for you one more time before you leave. Amen.